Thank you very much. That was quite the intro. I guess I am going to be using the mic after all, right? Mike? Mike? No, Mike? Okay. Just out of curiosity, have all of you had dinner? Yes? Okay, good. Because when you talk about microbes, you can't talk about microbes without talking about poo. So I will be discussing poo ad nauseum, literally and figuratively. So there'll be a lot of discussion on poo. Okay, so let me actually get my presentation up on the screen. And I hope I live up to the expectation. Oh, that should have been an image of Hippocrates. I'm not sure why it's not there. How many have heard of Hippocrates? You've heard of the Hippocratic Oath? You know, the father of medicine, Greek physician? You know, it's funny how ancient wisdom is being reinforced scientifically today. He said all disease begins in the gut. Now, I wouldn't go as far as to say all disease begins in the gut, but we know many do. And as Dave was saying, the wealth of research going on and has been going on for some time in as far as studying the microbiome is extraordinary. And we know that much of who we are, many of the conditions that we once never associated with the gut, are now linked directly to the gut. If you'd asked me 15 years ago, you can use probiotics to help with depression, anxiety, and stress, I would have said that's absurd. Now it's a reality. If you told me that, you know, our immune system is regulated by in large part our microbiome, I would have said, well, I doubt that, if you asked me 20 years ago, and now we know that to be true. So the field of microbiology is extraordinary. It's actually funny, because when I went to the University of Guelph, I went to good old U of Gu, as it's sort of affectionately known, and I studied microbiology. Back then, it was really, you know, being a microbiologist now in school would be an exciting time to be studying microbiology. It really is evolving beautifully. Let me get my little pointer. Okay. Now, this is a really great quote because it really speaks to me. The idea that our microbiome or microbiota is a forgotten organ. Now, how many have heard the term flora? Raise their hands. Do you know why they were called flora? Back in the day, a long, long time ago, they were part of the plant kingdom, right? So they were given that classification flora, and it stuck for a very long time, but that's not technically accurate, so it should be either microbiome or microbiota, but nonetheless, it's still commonly referred to as flora. And I love this study because they suggest that this microbiome is the forgotten organ. Well, how can it be a forgotten organ? Well, if you look at the metabolic complexities of those microbes and the things they do that are critical to our very survival, they really are a forgotten organ. I mean, none of you would ever argue the fact that your liver, your kidneys, your heart are critical to your survival. But once again, if asked a number of years ago, can you survive without microbes in your gut, you'd probably be, probably. And we know that you can't. If you were actually to sterilize your gut completely, you wouldn't live for many years after having it. And who knows, we don't know how long it would be. We know we've done this in animal studies, and they don't survive for very long without microbes in their gut, but we have no idea how long humans would survive. But if they did, for a while, they'd be very, very ill. So they really are a forgotten organ. And the problem is that many of us knowingly or unknowingly have abused this organ. We've done things that have affected it negatively. Now let's look at the number of microbes in the gut. And the first part of this presentation is really sort of going over the numbers, because I want you to kind of get a sense of just the sheer quantity of microbes that live within our gut. You know, when I first did this presentation many years ago, this was a different slide. It said there are 300 to 500 species that are believed to exist in the gut. Now it's gone up to 1,000. We have 10 times, I mean, just imagine this, 10 times more microbes in our gastrointestinal tract than we have cells in the human body. And those microbes contain 150 times more genetic material than there are genes in your actual cells. In fact, speaking of kind of breaking news, and I'm sure Dave would have heard this as well, I took a course on genomics recently, and this actually just came out about a month, month and a half ago. They discovered that 23 of our genes don't belong to us. Their origins are bacterial, viral, or fungal. So some of our actual genes we've inherited, if you will. Up until that study, it was believed that all of your genes are transferred by mom and dad, right? It's called horizontal gene transfer. And now they think that we're getting genes from microorganisms. That's called vertical gene transfer. And that's, you know, the implications of that we'll know, I'm sure, sometime in the future, but it's extraordinary to think that these genes part of us are made up of microbes. I don't know what's
going on. Okay, so the point of this next slide is just to really indicate that there are a lot of microbes, but there's actually more in the large intestine than there are in the small intestine.
So as you can see, in terms of the actual numbers per gram of contents in the large intestine versus the small, considerably more. And up to 55% of your poo, my first talk, so let's keep track of how many times I say poo. We're at number one. So up to 55% of your poo are made up of microbes. Isn't that extraordinary? That's a lot of microbes in one's feces, right? And we produce anywhere between 500 mils to 2 liters of gas a day. Pretty shocking amount of gas, isn't it? So who do you think flatulates more, men or women? It's a little survey. Given the fact that we have mostly women here, only a small number of men, I'm going to say most of you are going to say men, right? How many would say men produce more gas than women? Raise your hands.
They just don't care.
Well, yeah, the difference is, whereas women care and are discreet, men tend to brag about it and say, pull my finger, right? It's a bit of a difference there, right? Yeah. Well, for the people who think men do flatulate more than women, we do. And sure enough, an Australian research team decided to look into this, and men flatulate 10 times a day versus women who flatulate 8 times a day. So the probability that someone's flatulating at some point right now is highly probable. So, you know. Anyway, but that being said, there's an excuse you can give you for when you flatulate that'll kind of defer blame to something else other than yourself. Now, when you look at the microbes that live in our body, a lot of us think of microbes pretty much just colonizing the gastrointestinal tract, and that's not the case. Wherever there's mucus, there are microbes, right? So you'll find microbes in your lungs, in your gastrointestinal tract, you'll find them in your vaginal tract. So wherever there's mucus, there's going to be a microbe within the body. And there's also, of course, microbes on the skin, on the hair. So we have microbes all over us. In fact, there's some pretty cool research going on now for burn victims where they're using microbes topically to heal the skin and reduce the risk of infection. In fact, there's another great quote by Dr. McCann, which is, and I love this quote, probiotics will be in the 21st century what antibiotics were in the 20th century. And this is actually turning out to be true. We're starting to see probiotics being used when originally for the same kind of purpose at one time antibiotics were the go-to choice. So where do we get our probiotics? Where do you think you get a probiotic? Where do we get our probiotics from? Food, right? Obviously fermented foods. And how many here have fermented foods on a fairly consistent basis? Brilliant. And by the way, as wonderful as supplementation is, I can't overemphasize the importance of using probiotics from getting them from your foods, right? So have your sauerkraut, your miso, your tempeh, your kombucha. All of these are examples of, and many more. In fact, there is not a culture out there that I know of that doesn't consume some fermented food. And I always ask my audiences, you know, or anyone have a unique fermented food that's part of their culture? And, you know, be it a fermented fish, fermented meat, fermented vegetable, everyone has consumed in history some fermented food. And of course, there are some advantages to supplementation that are quite obvious, right? You can get a very controlled dose. You can say, okay, this is exactly how much you have in there. You don't really know exactly how much you have in that serving of sauerkraut or yogurt that you've consumed. It's portable. I don't think Dave's going to travel with a bottle of sauerkraut when he goes on his vacation tomorrow. Certainly you could try. I don't know if you get through customs, but you're certainly welcome to try. But you know, it's certainly there's some advantages to using it in a supplement form, but it should be also very important to recognize the value in using both food and supplemental probiotics. What's really important is to understand how critical it is for humans to establish this relationship with microbes early and as early as possible. And that's something that we have now started to really fully appreciate, but all too often hasn't been appreciated. So when are we actually first exposed? Well, for the longest time, it was believed that the womb was actually a sterile environment. It turns out it's not. It turns out there are some microbes in the womb, not a very large number as far as we can tell, but there are some microbes that exist in the womb. And we know that the baby's gastrointestinal tract is sterile, to the best of our knowledge once again, right? So when do you first get exposed? Well, the answer is when you pass through the mom's birth canal. And what happens is when that process happens, the baby takes on the mom's vaginal and rectal flora, or microbiome, right? So the mom transfers her microbes to the baby vaginally.
You also get further exposure, as this happy baby would suggest, by breastfeeding, right? Breastfeeding is another way of transferring these microbes from mom to baby. Now, interestingly enough, for the longest time, scientists believed that the way the mom passes on microbes to the baby via breastfeeding is by simple contact. So the baby is in contact with the mom's nipple, the mom's breast, and there's a transfer of microbes from mom to baby. And there is some of that going on for sure. But what's really remarkable in a very recent discovery, in fact, about 3 or 4 years ago, I came across another study that was amazing, suggesting that when they tested the microbes on the mom in the mom's breast milk, they were genetically the same as the microbes in the mom's gastrointestinal tract. So it was perplexing, right? Because, I mean, unless I missed an anatomy class, there is no direct link between the mom's gut and her breast, right? So how do they get from the gut to the breast? And it turns out there are these dendritic cells that basically engulf the microbes from the mom's intestinal tract and carry them into the mom's breast milk. So by breastfeeding a baby, you are actually passing on the mom's gut microbes, which is actually remarkably exciting, because if anyone's ever been born by C-section, it's rather encouraging to think that they're still getting some of the mom's gut microbes by way of breastfeeding, right? A little side note as well, it turns out that mom's milk, if they have celiac, seems to have a lower amount of probiotics relative to moms that don't have celiac disease. So maybe this would warrant a mom that has celiac. Certainly, I think if she has celiac, she should be using a probiotic regardless, but this should be added motivation. And what they also discovered just very recently is that the baby's immune system early in life is developed in such a way as to not think of those microbes as being foreign. So the body won't attack those microbes. The body says, I'm going to accept you and treat you like you're one of, you know, part of me, part of my own ecosystem, part of one of my, say, extension of my tissue, right? So the body does not reject these microbes early in life and establishes this relationship. That's why it's so critical that a baby born by C-section, a baby that can't be breastfed, be given a probiotic immediately as soon as they're born. The usual suggestion is don't have a probiotic until you're 1 year of age and older. And it's bordering on a crime, because that baby develops that relationship, that commensal relationship with the microbes early on. So don't wait a year or 2 years of their life to start using a probiotic. Give it to them early on. So of course the question has to be asked, the baby is not born vaginally, so therefore they're born by C-section. And so what? I mean, what's the consequence of a baby that's born by way of C-section? Well, there's a significant consequence, because we see statistically a much higher risk, a much higher prevalence of what's called atopic disease. Things like eczema, asthma, running of the nose and eyes, runny conjunctivitis. We see a much higher prevalence in C-section birth babies. Now, this is really relevant to me in more ways than one. Certainly, my child, my 3.5-year-old, he was actually born by way of C-section. And within 2 hours of his birth, he was given a probiotic. At the time, it was something called HMF Natogen, a great product by Genestra. So he was put on a probiotic immediately at birth. But how many babies are born by C-section never to see a probiotic until maybe much later in life? And that really is almost a tragedy. And what do you think reflects, what do you think is found in the gut of a baby who's born by C-section? If they're bypassing the mom's birth canal, where do the microbes come from? Well, you guessed it, they come from the environment. They come from the hospital environment. The gloves, the hands, the instrumentation, the hands of the mom and the dad, they come from areas outside of the normal way in which you would get the microbes, which is, you know, via the vaginal tract. In fact, a very interesting practice is actually a researcher from Australia who strongly advocates this practice. If a baby is born by C-section, you get the mom's vaginal fluids and rub it all over the baby and actually put some of it inside the baby's mouth. Now that might sound, I say that and some people kind of go, all of us that were born vaginally would have taken in our mom's fluid anyway. So whether it happens naturally or whether it's something someone does in a hospital, the net result is colonize the baby with the good microbes from the mom, right? So that's an important thing that I know that some midwives and some doulas that are taking part in C-section, because they're allowed to be there during the C-section, they sometimes strongly encourage that practice be done. but I don't think it's being done enough, frankly. Okay, so this interesting study, I think it's taken a bit of a leap, but they suggest that the reason why we've seen an explosion, an epidemic, and this is their exact word, an epidemic in autoimmune diseases like the ones you see there, and an epidemic of allergic diseases, in large part is due to just the sheer number of C-section deliveries that are happening around the globe. And there are more and more. It's become kind of this sort of crazy thing where, it's famous in parts of the U.S. where a lot of celebrities will actually choose elective C-sections. They've got a movie shoot going on, and it conflicts with their delivery date, so they actually set a firm date. It's kind of insane to think that that's happening. You know, sometimes a C-section is medically necessary, as was the case in my wife's for my wife. But when you're doing it electively, it's a shame, because I think if the parent knew what they were doing to their child, they would choose not to go that route. And interesting little, oddly, I don't even know why, but interesting little stat. Newfoundland and BC have the highest incidence of C-sections. And I find that perplexing. My wife's from Vancouver. I always imagine, having been born and raised in Toronto, people in BC choose to give birth by the ocean with orcas in the background, drums beating, incense, But to think that they would actually elect to go kind of such a, go the C-section route is sort of a bit surprising. I'm not sure why that is more prevalent in BC and Newfoundland than it is in places like Ontario. If you were to ask me, I'd think Ontario would have been top, but it's not. And we also know that, of course, for sometimes out of necessity, a mom can't breastfeed her child. Now, if the baby is born as a premature baby, the mom is often not even producing breast milk, right? Or sometimes the mom goes on certain medications during her time of breastfeeding, where she has to stop breastfeeding. But in cases where a baby isn't breastfed and they are therefore formula fed, there is a significant difference in the microbiome of the baby's gut versus a baby that is breastfed. An incredible difference, right? So imagine a scenario, a bit of a double whammy, where a baby is born by C-section and is being formula fed. So they're kind of bypassing that natural process altogether, which really once again reinforces the idea you should all be on a probiotic, or a baby should be on a probiotic right from birth, especially if they've been born by C-section or if they have been formula fed. And this is interesting, because it just goes to show you, we have a certain degree of arrogance, right? It's 2015, we kind of know it all. And the attitude has always been, we think we know how everything works, and therefore, if it's really deemed to be of no value, let's take it out. That was true with me when I was a kid. I had my tonsils yanked out. How many here had a tonsillectomy? Now, if you look around, most of us tend to be, I'm 45, you tend to be 40 and older. That sort of practice is no longer encouraged. Do you know why? Back when I got them yanked out, they were kind of there for the ride. They weren't really thought of as being of any value. Are tonsils valuable? They certainly are. So, don't get me wrong, they still do tonsillectomies, but they really do everything else they can before electing to remove those tonsils, right? Fast forward to the present day. Appendix, right? It's this, what's called a vestigial organ. In other words, it's a remnant of our ancestral past. In other words, it's believed that if we fast forward 1,000 years from now, that thing would be gone. It would just eventually get smaller and smaller and smaller and disappear. Right, because it's really something left over from our ancestry. That's called a vestigial organ. Well, it turns out that little flap is more than just this remnant of our ancestral past. It's a little storage vessel, if you will, for microbes. And what they found is if you had a massive gastrointestinal infection, if you had something like a C. difficile, ever heard of C. difficile, Clostridium difficile, if you had an infection, and you have your appendix, you actually do far better because it repopulates the gut, right? Now, I'm not by any means suggesting if you have a case of appendicitis, you fight with your doctor and say, "Doc, I'm sorry, I absolutely refuse to have my appendix," because I'll tell you, the alternative is possibly death. So I'm not suggesting you fight for your appendix at the cost of your life, but just to show that, we're always learning new things. And even though we have this attitude that science knows it all, something as simple as the appendix is now being seen very differently than it was just 10 years ago. So why do we need to use probiotics? How many of you have heard the term dysbiosis? Raise your hands. Okay. In the most general of terms, it simply refers to an imbalance of microbes in the gut, where you typically have more bad than you should, and the bad guys are called pathogens, E. coli, Salmonella, Candida, C. diff, H. pylori. So you have more of the bad and not enough of the good. And in the world of microbes, it's a balance, right? By the way, most of us here, at least two-thirds of us statistically, likely have H. pylori. Some of you with H. pylori may develop an ulcer, and others don't, right? So we all have some bad bugs, but it's a numbers game. You want to always have more of the good to keep the bad in check. I always say, it's sort of an analogy, it's like living on a street. If you've got eight really great kids and you've got two bullies, the eight kids will keep the two bullies at bay. But if you switch that around and you have eight bullies and two good kids, they're going to get wedgies every single day of the week. They're going to get bullied to death, right? So you want to keep the numbers always in favor of the good and keep the bad in check. And we know there are many things that we can do that actually do, in fact, promote dysbiosis. Diet being a key one. Too many processed foods. Too much sugar. What's a pathogen? What's a bad bug that we associate with often excessive sugar intake? It's a fungus. It's a yeast. Begins with C.
Candida,
right? We know too much animal fat. We know too little vegetable and fruit intake. All of these things favor dysbiosis. And here we have this interesting study, and I actually made a mistake. It's not a European village. It's actually Europe. They looked at children in Europe in relation, and look at their microbiome, their makeup of microbes in relation to children in this African village that have a very traditional diet. And to Dave's point, I always called it Firmicutes, but it's Firmicutes, I guess. Is that how is it? Tomato, tomato? I don't really know. Okay, so Firmicutes sounds almost a little bit more fluid than Firmicutes, but if you look at Firmicutes, you'll notice that it's a fairly small proportion in red relative to the larger, more dominant family of microbes. I call them bacteroidetes. I'm not sure if that's the correct pronunciation either. But if you look at the European children, they have a much higher population of Firmicutes relative to the bacteroidetes. Now remember what Dave said, what did he talk about? What were the organisms that have been shown to be more effective at sort of storing fat, taking in fat and allowing us to have higher fat stores in the body? Was it Firmicutes? It certainly was, right? So we see that the diet, a more traditional and more, if you will, ancestral diet, most certainly favors a healthy ecology. And when the diet is not favorable, when it's very processed, like so much of our diets are, sadly nowadays, it in fact favors this imbalance. You want to be more in this spectrum than you want to be in that. We know compromised immune function can certainly predispose one to increased risk of dysbiosis. You know, even drinking poor water, I mean, why do they chlorinate water? To kill microbes. You think it just kills the bad ones? Well, of course it'll affect the good as well. Poor digestion, absorption, stress. You know, what does stress not affect? We have very clear evidence stress increases the risk of heart disease, cancer, and the list goes on. We know that stress impacts everything, including, as it turns out, the balance of microbes in the gut. It seems that stress and the chemicals we produce as a consequence of stress, in fact, favor the bad over the good. Suppressing these good guys, lactobacilli and bifidobacterium. So even stress can have an impact. Being overweight and obese, and I'll talk about this, speaking of a new research, you're gonna find this part later on in the presentation really quite fascinating, but if you're overweight and obese, consistently you take stool samples, we'll always see a different ratio of microbes in those that are obese and overweight relative to those that are not. Drugs, and not just the obvious offender. I mean, Dave absolutely touched on the most relevant of drugs when it comes to messing up our gut environment, the antibiotic. But even other drugs have been shown to have an impact, the negative impact. Ever heard of gastroesophageal reflux disease? So gastroesophageal reflux disease, in fact, the drugs commonly prescribed for that, H2 antagonists, beta blockers, they're the most prescribed drugs used across North America. In fact, one of the most prescribed drugs, family of drugs used around the globe. And you might say, well, how would that impact the microbiology, the microbiome in the gut? It turns out by reducing stomach acid levels, right, by cutting back on the stomach acid, that barrier that would be normally there that would protect from bugs getting through into the intestine is compromised, meaning it's no longer as acidic. So bugs that would normally try to get through the stomach but would have been killed by that strong stomach acid, because it's been buffered, it's not as acidic, not as much as being produced, what ends up happening is they get through. So what do we see? A much higher incidence of gastrointestinal infections in those that are on these class of medications, right? Especially increased incidence of C. diff. But without a doubt, the biggest offender are antibiotics. And not just antibiotics that you are prescribed. I mean, yes, have they been abused? Absolutely. Now, I'm, by the way, not here to bash antibiotics. Antibiotics probably have, maybe some of us are here directly or indirectly because of antibiotics. Maybe one of our grandparents or one of our, you know, our mom or dad could have had such a severe infection that would have killed them were it not for an antibiotic. So antibiotics have played a very important role, but have they been overused and abused? Absolutely. There's so many examples of antibiotics being prescribed where they're not necessary. If you have a sinus infection, most of them are fungal. An antibiotic does diddly against the fungus. If you've got influenza, antibiotics don't kill a virus. They don't help with a viral infection. So all too often they're prescribed unnecessarily. But aside from what we are prescribed, I think another huge issue is the use of antibiotics in animal feed, in the world of veterinary medicine. In fact, the overwhelming majority of all antibiotics produced, 80% or more, don't go towards medicine for humans. They're used for in farms. They're used to not only treat the animals, but, and this is really what upsets me, they're used in animal feed as a way to allow the animal to grow more quickly. You may not be aware of this, but when you know, I haven't done this for many years. The idea that using antibiotics in animal feed improves what's called feed efficiency. It's called enhanced feed efficiency. Two identical cows, one given antibiotic in the feed, the other is not. Who do you think is going to grow faster? Who's going to get fatter sooner? Who's going to ultimately get to market sooner? It boils down to economics. The animal and the antibiotic actually gets faster. This is a practice, by the way, that's been absolutely condemned by scientists around the globe. The European Economic Community in 2006 banned this practice in Europe. Have we banned it in Canada? We have not. The US hasn't banned it. And not only do we ingest, not only do we consume antibiotics in our meat, but we also, unfortunately, have been finding that a lot of these meats have antibiotic-resistant strains in the meat as well. Right? You hear a lot about these antibiotic-resistant superbugs, right? When I was in University of Guelph, one of my professors was a marine microbiologist, and she said, oh, it's very common practice to give fish in fish farms antibiotics. Not in this case because they grow faster, but because they're in such close proximity to each other. When one gets an infection, it spreads like rapid fire, right? It's like a kid in a daycare. One sneezes and they all have a cold, right? The reality is that they're using antibiotics, in this case, to prevent infection. So when you have fish that's farmed, you can pretty much guarantee there's some antibiotics in there as well. Maybe not the organic farm fish, which, you know, they won't go into the organic farming practice when it comes to fishing, aquaculture, but the point is a lot of the food we consume often unknowingly does have antibiotics. So please try to make a point of avoiding foods that contain antibiotics in them. And a lot of them will actually, if it's organic by default, they can't do this practice can't be used. But a lot of chicken, like meat or eggs will say antibiotic free now. Right, so try to look for an antibiotic-free option as well. And I really discourage the use of antibiotic soaps. When I was at Guelph, this little experiment, we washed one hand with regular soap, the other hand with one of those sort of antibiotic soaps. We put it on top of a petri dish, and which is what you use to kind of culture bacteria. And you looked at, you know, the growth. And what we found was that, in fact, these soaps that contain these antimicrobial compounds were actually worse for you. Because yes, they killed off some microbes. They also killed off some of the good guys that kept the bad in check. So really, look at the soaps that you buy and they say antimicrobial. Try to avoid them, okay? And the most offensive of things that I can imagine in one of those soaps would be triclosan. I'm not going to go into the hormone-disrupting effects of it as well, but it's really quite bad. And Dr. Blazer, who's a researched and published author, in fact, in this wonderful book, if you want to really kind of get freaked out about antibiotics, read this book. If not, I wouldn't recommend reading it. But if you read this book, he says that the abuse or overuse of antibiotics are, in fact, this is a direct quote, fueling our modern day plagues, right? Now, this is a little interesting graph.
Because what we have here is an example of the impact of antibiotics on our gut. In this study, they gave individuals a 1 week course of antibiotics. And just before they were given the antibiotics at day zero, they looked at the diversity of microbes in the gut of the individuals. And those different bands of color reflect different families of microbes. And notice all the different colors, right? After the antibiotic was given, they then tested their stool to see what kind of diversity was there after the antibiotic was used. And notice that after 9 months, minimal diversity. You start to see some at 12, 18. You start to get a bit more diversity 2 years. That's 24 months after the antibiotic was used. And in fact, it may very well be that we never have the exact same microbial ecology after using antibiotics that we had prior to using it, right? Now, you can certainly change this and make it, you know, change it and change it much more quickly by using a quality probiotic. It won't maybe necessarily get it back to the way it was, but it certainly can have a profound impact. And we know that. We've seen that in studies where those that use antibiotics and a probiotic concurrently, what that means is, and I want to clarify this, you don't use an antibiotic and a probiotic at the exact same time, but you use it on the same day and put at least 2 or 3 hours between the two doses. This is, by the way, a departure from what was recommended years ago. When I first got into this field some 20 years ago, the protocol was very simple. Only use a probiotic after you finish the antibiotic. That's no longer the accepted sort of norm. That's not the way to do it. Take the probiotic alongside the antibiotic, but put as many hours between the two doses as possible. So if you know someone who's on antibiotics, tell them to not wait until they're done, start using. There's a reason for it. I wish I could go into it in more detail, but it just has to do with, by using a probiotic alongside an antibiotic, you prevent the what's called opportunistic pathogens, the bad bugs, who aren't killed by the antibiotic, taking over, right? You prevent them from becoming the dominant species that are, you know, in charge of the gut. You keep them at bay. Microbes and vaccines. This is a very interesting topic because what's interesting is that a lot of us in this field of holistic medicine have some concerns regarding not only the vaccines directly, the actual, you know, attenuated viruses or whatever the case might be, but also the preservatives, the adjuvants that are used to stabilize them, the thimerosal, which is mercury, or the aluminum, or the various, you know, the formaldehyde. There are a lot of chemicals used to stabilize vaccines. So is it the actual organism, or is it the actual stabilizing ingredient, or is it the fact that they give people too many kids too many vaccines too quickly and too many of them? Is the interval between vaccinations too aggressive? It's probably all of those factors that have a lot of us concerned. But what's interesting is there is some evidence suggesting that probiotics may offer some protection to those that are concerned about this potential, what's called vaccine injury. The concern for vaccine injury may be somewhat minimized if you take a probiotic alongside a vaccine. So if someone elects to vaccinate their children or vaccinate themselves, it's sort of at least a bit more reassuring to know there may be something one can do to help with this. Now, the beauty is if you see Jacqueline and Dave, do you use sort of the drainage protocol by Dr. Adams? Right, so if you see someone like Jacqueline and already, I'm sure Dave is already up to speed on it, but when he graduates as well, there's a protocol that allows you to get rid of the junk that's in a vaccine. So those that choose to vaccinate can still help get that stuff out of the body more efficiently. It's a protocol put together by Dr. Adams. I'm sure there's other protocols as well. But so you've taken that that vaccine thing by Dr. Adams that you had okay, so go talk to Jacqueline. She can hook you up. Okay, and I find this next section remarkably interesting because it's something that I've always intuitively felt to be true, but now there's growing evidence that in fact it is true. It's called the hygiene hypothesis. How many here have heard of the hygiene hypothesis? I see some of you nodding your heads. So either you're about to fall asleep and you're nodding your head, or you actually understand. Yes, you've heard of it. Okay, good to know. And it's really a very simple premise. The premise is that if we make our environment too clean, and if we really over-sanitize our environment, we reduce our exposure to things that we should be exposed to make us stronger, more robust, more competent when it comes to later in life
dealing with those challenges, right? And really, if you think about it, everywhere you go, there's a dispenser for Purell on every wall. You know, we've got Lysol wipes. We've got all these different sterilizing and sanitizing things that are everywhere around us, right? We pasteurize our food. If you go back a couple of generations, my dad said, oh, we used to eat food that was kind of like bordering on going off, but you know, they were poor farmers. You'd eat it, right? I mean, they had bread that had mold. You wouldn't toss the bread. They'd just scrape off the mold, right? So, I mean, people were just on a regular basis exposed to stuff, you know? And now it's the cleaner, the better. Now, don't get me wrong, there is a balance, right? You don't want to have, you know, sewage running down the streets like was at one time the case, right? You don't want having cholera outbreaks and things like that. So there is a balance, but have we gone too far to the other extreme? And I think the answer is we have, right? So just to read this verbatim, reducing exposure to microorganisms and allergens increases susceptibility to illness like allergies, immune dysfunction, etc. And I love this little kind of little comic, this clip. You've got this child, he's all covered in dirt, he comes home, his mom isn't too thrilled, and he just says, Mom, I'm just here to really help you with your IBS, right? He's trying to bring in some bugs that'll hopefully make his mom less likely to have her IBS. So what evidence do we have that in fact this hygiene hypothesis may in fact be true? Well, this is an interesting study. They looked at three neighboring countries, Finland, Karelia, and Estonia. Now, interestingly, in this study, Finland has one of the highest rates of type 1 diabetes, in fact, in Europe. Super high incidence of type 1 diabetes. They also happen to, maybe coincidentally, they would suggest not, they also happen to be the most hygienic of the three countries. So now let's look at Karelia, which is considered to be the least hygienic of the three. And their incidence of diabetes is 6 times lower than Finland's. And it's sort of like Goldilocks and the Three Bears. Estonia is right in the middle, intermediate hygiene levels, hygiene practices. And their incidence of diabetes, type 1 diabetes specifically, is half that of Finland. Now this is one of many examples. People who have pets and have babies, children, raised in their household have a lower risk of allergies later in life. Children born into families that live on farms also have a lower risk of allergies, lower risk of atopic disease, etc. We see that consistently. And a very unusual study, they actually did this just a few years ago, and they found that if a baby sleeps on an animal fur, they too have a lower risk of allergies. So if you have any Viking friends that can lend you a pelt, you can ask them if you could borrow it for a couple of years while the baby's growing up. So anyway, there's really a lot of evidence of this. And now you might say, okay, that's, I guess, kind of funny, but kind of gross. What does this have to do with this presentation? Well, you'll see in a moment. So everyone had a chance to read that? Bunch of noses that are students saying, pick me, and the teacher's a finger, right? So what could this have to do with anything that we are talking about? Well, it has a lot to do with that. How many have heard of mucophagy? What does the sound, what does muco sound like? What would be an extension of that word muco? If you were to, mucus, right. Ophagy, the intake or consumption of, you guessed it. It's picking your nose and eating it. It's eating your mucus, yummy. See, I told you it's gonna be a pretty gross, that's why I asked if you all had your dinner like a long time ago. This would be an appetite killer if you were eating after this presentation. Whether we want to admit it or not, all of us probably picked our nose and ate it. You know, let's be honest. Anyone here have children? Anyone that never saw ever their child eat their own booger? My 3-year-old thinks it's a delicacy. Now, the funny thing is my wife and I have a different perspective on this, right? Even though she's a pediatric nurse, she's like, that's gross, stop that, Oliver. And I kind of under my breath say, it's okay, son. It's okay. Just colonize your gut. So I tend to have a much more relaxed approach about this than she does. Now, what could this have to do with hygiene hypothesis? Well, sure enough, leave it to good old University of Saskatchewan to do this kind of research. This researcher suggests that, in fact, our mucus tastes quite sweet. And if you wonder how he found this out, well, you can imagine, he tried it. And he suggests that there's an evolutionary mechanism at play here, that it tastes sweet to entice children to consume. And now all of us have, we eat mucus, on, you have a cold and the mucus runs in the back of your throat. We all ingest mucus. But what's interesting about mucus is that it's a form of almost, think of an oral vaccine, right? It traps dust, it traps allergens, it traps viruses and bacteria, right? And then, yeah, gobble it up. And you kind of help strengthen the child's immune system, right? So it is, as gross as it might sound, I think it really does make a great deal of sense. There's actually a professor out of Europe who makes the exact same argument, that eating one's mucus as a child may be part of that developing one's immune system, sort of that process of developing one's immune system. Okay, benefits of probiotics. And this could be easily a discussion that would take forever, so I can't go and spend a lot of time on all the benefits and go into each of them in any kind of detail. But I just want to really leave you with a sense of some of the things that probiotics have been shown in studies to do, and do often quite brilliantly. Amazing for the skin, eczema, psoriasis, and acne. In fact, something I would have never thought of, which I only know of because people have actually tried this. It wouldn't have been something I would have thought of, where they make a paste out of a probiotic and then apply it to their skin. And some have had some remarkable success doing that, which only makes sense if you consider that your skin would have been coated with your mom's, once again, vaginal flora. So if you've got something that's disrupted that thing, you know, that balance, putting some good microbes there might be of benefit. Immune function. A very significant part of our immune function is regulated by the gut, our mucosal immunity. So when you have someone who is consistently coming down with colds and has clearly some immune challenge, or someone that has autoimmune disease, you know, what's really quite, once again, a bit baffling is Health Canada says every company that sells a probiotic in Canada must have a warning on the box, on the product, saying, you know, not to use or avoid caution when using it when you have an autoimmune disease. Yet that kind of goes against everything I've ever read in the studies, because what we see are probiotics actually balancing immune function. So if you have an autoimmune disease, in the simplest of terms, the simplest ways of describing it, your body's immune system is overly aggressive and it's attacking its own self, right? So if you have rheumatoid arthritis, you're attacking your own cartilage, your own joint, right? So the idea of using a probiotic, I think from Health Canada's perspective, is, oh, what if it makes the already overly active immune system, the aggressive immune system, all the more aggressive? I get it. That would be not a good idea, not a very good strategy. But what if, instead of that, what if a supplement actually were able to balance, regulate, or the more appropriate term is, modulate immune function? Probiotics have been shown to do that. So it's a bit baffling why someone with lupus or MS would be not told to use a probiotic when the evidence suggests that really their immune balancing or immune modulating properties would indicate using a probiotic in those cases. For both cancer prevention and treatment, it's been shown to reduce the risk of colorectal cancer. So there are certain chemicals that you've probably heard of called carcinogens that certain probiotics render less harmful, less carcinogenic, okay? We know if someone actually has cancer and they often are on, say, a chemo or they're on radiotherapy and they develop diarrhea as a consequence, probiotics can help with that as well. And remember, cancer treatments like traditional, conventional, like chemo and radiation, are designed to kill, unless they're biological, but they're designed to kill cells in a kind of very kind of blitzkrieg sort of way. It's really, if the cell multiplies very quickly, it will try to kill it. Of course, cancer cells multiply very quickly, but so do other cells. What other cells multiply very quickly in the body? The most rapidly multiplying cells in the body are our intestinal cells. So as you would imagine, the intestinal cells get hit really hard when someone undergoes chemotherapy. What other cells get hit hard? Your hair cells, which is why people often lose their hair, right? So the idea of using a probiotic when someone has cancer makes a great deal of sense. If you've got leaky gut, probiotics are an absolute must-use supplement. And by the way, leaky gut was for many years thought of in Western medicine as a figment of our imagination. And really now, leaky gut has been accepted as being, it's been scientifically validated, right? And yet for many years, it was, oh, it's these people in the industry that are just making up this fictitious condition, right? And now it's been recognized as existing, right? If you have inflammatory bowel disease, the umbrella term for ulcerative colitis and Crohn's, probiotics are remarkable. If you've got IBS, food allergies, both food or airborne allergies. It helps modulate immune function. I don't want to go into all the immunology that's in sort of at play that regulates this, but it does help with allergies. For those that have chronic diarrhea or constipation, I'll share an amazing story with you. This one client that I was working with, she was actually out of Regina, had such severe constipation for 2 decades, and I can't even imagine this, she was on laxatives to have normal bowel movements. That was the only way she could go to the bathroom, was a laxative. And she started using a probiotic, within 3 to 4 weeks, started developing diarrhea, unheard of, went off the laxative, and I quote, started having normal, as she put it, I started having wonderful bowel movements again, right? And she was so happy, she shared it with my audience of 90 people, right? So, you know, when you're willing to brag about how good your poo is, you know you're obviously happy about it. And no one would argue how important a good poo is, right? So 20 years of being backed up, having some regular movements can be a wonderful thing. GI infections, and this little thing in red, disgust. You're like, oh God, I don't want to hear about a sewer study. Do I really have to hear about a sewer study? Well, yes you do, because this one is interesting. Have you heard about this study, Dave? The studying the sewers of 17 cities in the U.S. Does that ring a bell at all? Okay, this is going to be exciting. Well, I think it was. Anyway, but I'm a weirdo that way, so what excites me may not excite you at all. We'll find out.
Who excites me?
What's that?
Who is great?
Oh, this is going to excite you, because I know you, and this is going to excite you. But so the scientists in the U.S. said, if we were to study the sewage in 17 cities in the U.S., could we, by just analyzing the microbes in those sewers, predict the obesity rates in those cities? Now, some of the scientists said, there's no way that there's going to be a correlation between poo and the obesity rates. Sure enough, there was. They're almost 80 to 85% accurate. So just by analyzing the sewer poo and looking at the microbial makeup of that sewage, they were able to very accurately determine the obesity rates within that city. So as you would expect, the cities that had highest levels of obesity had more of those microbes that had been linked to being obese. And the opposite was true for those cities that had less obese individuals, right? So that's my sewer study. Was that interesting, or am I just a weirdo? Is that anyone find that interesting? No? Yeah, is that good? Thank you. I'll take one person saying that was good. That made me happy. Anyway, we also in the probiotics actually not only can enhance the absorption of vitamins and minerals, but they actually synthesize certain vitamins, family of B vitamins, vitamin K. So in fact, we know that when you give often premature babies a probiotic, they seem to gain weight more quickly, right? We know they can have a huge impact on mood and behavior and stress and anxiety. And this is really amazing. You know, we know that probiotics can manufacture precursors to serotonin, GABA. They can reduce the levels of what's called neurotoxic compounds. These are chemicals that are harmful to the brain. So they can have a huge, we often talk about now the second brain, making reference to the gut microbiome, right? It's our second brain. You know, that's, you used to always say figuratively, I've got a gut feeling, it's a gut reaction. You know, I got a gut sense. Well, it turns out it's more than just figurative, it's really literal, right? And you know, they always say the weight of man's heart is through his gut. It turns out that actually is true as well, because there's evidence that probiotics have an impact on cardiovascular function, cholesterol. So that is true. The weight of a man's heart and a woman's heart is also likely connected to the gut. And autism, a lot of interesting research on autism. I actually go into this. If you want a more detailed presentation on this topic, you can visit my website, keepwell.ca, and I go into this sort of association between autism and the gut in more detail. But it can improve so many things. By the way, a phenomenal book by Dr. Gershon, one of the foremost authorities on the gut-brain axis, the second brain. And these are some of the mechanisms that are believed to be at play that allow for the microbiome in the gut to impact our mood, our stress, etc. And something that you may not always think about, if you use a probiotic that is not enteric-coated, anyone here not know what enteric coating is? Okay, enteric coating is simply a process by which they coat a capsule or a tablet with a substance that protects it from stomach acid. Okay, so it resists stomach acid, so it doesn't break down in the stomach, and it'll break down when it gets into the duodenum, okay, into the intestine. If you're going to use a probiotic in certain, depending on the way you're going to use it, you may or may not want to use an enteric-coated capsule. Now, in this case, it may be not as relevant, but I'll tell you an example where it is very relevant. If any of you have a sore throat, I would strongly encourage you open up the capsule and gargle with it. The feedback we get on our probiotic is absolutely extraordinary. For sore throats, gingivitis, mouth ulcers, canker sores, thrush, which is candida, right? Absolutely remarkable. And another really kind of, have you ever tried brushing your teeth with probiotic, Dave?
No.
Okay, try this if you can. When you're, are you heading down south, like Mexico or?
I'm going to Miami and then to Bahamas, actually.
Oh, beautiful. You ever been to Bahamas?
Once.
Beautiful. Okay, nice. Well, it's beautiful. So, I don't know why I just talked about his vacation, but it intrigued me. I just want to know where he was going. In case I decide to stalk him again, I know where to follow him to, right? Anyway, the point is, if you have a chance to try this, open up a capsule, and after you brush your teeth and rinse up the toothpaste, open up a capsule and put the powder on the toothbrush and brush your teeth again. But this time, don't rinse. Leave it in your mouth and go to bed. And when you wake up in the morning, do that tongue over your teeth experiment, right, to see what kind of fur, how much fur you have on your teeth, right? That's a biofilm that's made up of bacteria, often karyogenic or cavity-causing bacteria. You'll notice that it's been reduced dramatically, like dramatically, right? So try that little experiment, you'll be surprised. But if you have any kind of oral issues, a probiotic in the capsule that you swallow won't do you as much good as opening it up and using it orally. So I gargle with it. I get quite lazy, so I don't usually brush my teeth. What I do in the night is I open up the capsule, put it in my mouth, have a swig of water, swish, 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 and then swallow and off to bed before I brush my teeth, right? So, or after I brush my teeth. So that's something that I would suggest you try. Add it to your juice, add it to your yogurt if you consume yogurt. Add it to, if anyone have protein shakes in the morning? Okay, for those of you, quite if you're nodding your heads, open up the capsule, add it to your protein shake. If you have a child or an infant, like if it's a baby, I mean it's a newborn, the simple thing to do is just open it up and apply it directly to the mom's nipple, and the baby will just get it from the mom's nipple when the baby breastfeeds. You can add it to the formula, you can add it to the yogurt, you can add it to the applesauce. Dr. Dixon Tom would suggest something kind of interesting, which is lick your finger. If you're the mom, lick your finger, dip it in the probiotic powder, then let your baby suck on the finger to get both the mom's oral and the probiotic species. So there are a lot of different things you can do, but open up the capsule with some frequency to get the benefits. And if you have some bacterial vaginosis, if you've got candida, if you've got any kind of UTI, using a probiotic both orally and vaginally, and I mean literally in this case vaginally inserting the capsule, and this gets back to my point that I should have made just a second ago, which is the enteric coating process would not be a good, you would never want to use an enteric coated capsule vaginally. Why? Because the vaginal environment is actually acidic. That capsule will not dissolve. And we know firsthand women that didn't know this, that have tried this, and days later, they end up passing out an entirely whole capsule. So don't use one that is not enteric coated, okay? And this is interesting. I did a talk in Ottawa some time ago, and there was an obstetrician gynecologist, a pediatrician in my audience, and I was talking about, I've heard of GBS infections. An unfortunate practice here in Canada is if you're gonna have a baby in a hospital, you go and see your OBGYN, they'll check to see if you may be GBS positive, group B strep positive, and what they're going to check for is to see if you have this bacteria. The concern being, if the bacteria gets transferred from mom to the baby, it could be dangerous. The reality is, the odds of that happening are so small. What sort of the, is, do they talk with the naturopathic college? Do they discourage it? Do they have a position on the UV, the IV antibiotic use, or do they tend to take a very precautious approach? Yeah, because in actually a lot of parts of the world, they actually do not use, do what we do in Canada. In Canada, what they do is if you test positive for this, the protocol is when the mom goes into labor, she gets put on a very powerful IV antibiotic to kill off this, but do you think it just kills this off? No, it doesn't. It kills off many of the good guys as well. So definitely one of those things that one can consider to use is actually a product by Genestra. It's these little ovules that contain a probiotic alongside garlic, which could be an effective strategy for a woman who gets tested and found to be GBS positive. You know, if she can try to get that under control before she gets tested again, she may hopefully not have to go on the IV antibiotic, right? Okay, so now we get to the actual probiotics that you see here. I want to spend just a few minutes, and it really won't be very much time at all, highlighting some of their unique features. Right off the bat, you may notice the name HCP, and that stands for human colonizing probiotic, because all of these strains are human-sourced. It's another fun part of the discussion. Because for those that don't know where human strains come from, hold on to your seats. In the world of probiotics, you have four options. You have human, you have vegetable, you have dairy, and you have soil. All right, soil-based organisms, soil-bound organisms. And certainly in terms of the research, we know that human, vegetable, and dairy have shown remarkable therapeutic benefits. But human strain probiotics seem to have the ability to be better colonizers of the gastrointestinal tract than non-human strains. Let me elaborate as to what I mean by that. If you look at a human strain microbe, it stays in the gut. It's able to more efficiently attach itself to the cells of the intestine called the epithelial cells. There's better what they call epithelial adhesion. They're able to colonize and set up shop and stay in the gut for longer stretches than can non-human strains. Non-human strains are typically more transient. Good for you? Yes. But they tend to go through you and not to stay in the gut as long. So the question is, okay, human, dairy, vegetable. Well, where do they come from? Anybody know where human strain probiotics are sourced from? Anybody want to say, I mean, I know you know, of course. And my colleague Melissa knows. By the way, Melissa was nice enough to tell me as we're walking up the stairs into the church, oh, by the way, this is going to be videotaped and it's going to be on YouTube. I'm like, oh, thank you for letting me know 3 minutes before I'm on. Anyway, so Melissa knows, you know, a few people know here, but anyone want to take a guess as to where they source human strain probiotics from? I heard someone say the what's poo? Yeah, you got it. All human strain probiotics come from human feces. Now, before all of you gag at the thought of consuming a fecal strain, just think there is no other place from which you can get intestinal bacteria other than human poo, right? I'd love to tell you we get them from butterflies. You know, we capture unicorns and we get them from unicorns. A lot more appealing than the idea of getting them from poo, but you have to get them from poo. But here's the important point to note. They were isolated some 23, 24 years ago, and ever since their first isolation, they've been grown in a medium, in a broth that has no poo in it whatsoever. It's not like we have a fresh batch that we collect every week. We don't knock on Melissa's door and say it's time for your weekly contribution. These have not seen feces in over 20 years, right? And if you think that is, you know, remember, in fact, I always say if you eat mushrooms or organic foods that are grown in manure, you've come in much more direct contact to poo of the bovine variety than you ever have with ours, right? And if you think that's gross, just think of a worst case scenario, which has been now a fairly common practice, and I think some of you may know where I'm going with this. You're nodding your head, so you know exactly where I'm going with this. If someone has a really nasty gut infection that is not responding to antibiotics, a big thing that's being now used in across Canada, even in hospitals, and not in only, actually largely in hospitals, is called fecal transplantation. And as the name may suggest, they literally get feces from a healthy donor, and usually it's a member of the family, and they get it from the donor and put it into the, they inject it, they fuse it into the rectum, into the gut of someone who's not well. And it has saved lives. Where people have been going down a road that would lead them ultimately to their demise, have had literally almost a miraculous recovery through this process of fecal, just Google fecal transplantation, right? So before any of us end up having to ask cousin Joe for his stool, let's try avoiding that process altogether and, and try using probiotics and sauerkraut and miso and tempeh and kimchi. Let's try that route before we end up finding ourselves having some real gut issues. Okay, so very quickly, I just want to mention, I'll just maybe a couple slides. Human colonizing probiotic, 30-71-50, as Dave mentioned. We have 30 billion. This is for every two capsules. 70 billion for every two caps. These are, by the way, these are the number of microbes at expiry, not at date of manufacture. And our most potent one today, called the HCP-150 critical support, has 150 billion for every two caps. So if someone has generally very good gut health, they've had really, having used antibiotics for maybe many, many, many years, they tend to have a balanced diet, eat a lot of fruits and vegetables and fiber, and tend to not eat a lot of processed foods, you know, they would probably be okay having the HCP-30. If you start having some sort of more significant gut issues, go up in potency. If you've got IBD, IBS, if you've done a course of antibiotics, if you've come back from Mexico and you just have massive gut issues, I always say go big. You know, larger numbers, a great, and a lot of different microbes is sort of the way to go. And we actually use six strains. We use 3 lactobacilli and 3 bifidobacteria, reason being that different strains tend to colonize certain areas over others, right? So generally, this is a generality, the lactobacilli tend to be the ones that tend to dominate the small intestine and the vaginal tract. Bifidobacteria, the large intestine. So it makes sense to use a blend of both, right? To give you, in fact, salivarius, the name even salivarius implies the origin, saliva, the oral cavity. You know, in fact, kids have been shown that use salivarius at a lower risk of throat infections and ear infections, less risk of strep throat. So using this blend is going to give you that what we call complete GI or gastrointestinal tract protection, including vaginal protection as well. And then lastly, I'm going to sort of skip. This is, by the way, shelf stable. That's the stability. I'm going to kind of cut to the chaser. You want to have it always. I want to make this very, very clear. Always have it with food. I don't want to go into the specifics of this, but because it's not enteric coated, it must be taken with food. Why? Food buffers stomach acid, makes it less acidic. So when you have a probiotic on an empty stomach, the stomach's acidity is sufficiently acidic, pH of 1 to 2, that it actually will kill many of those microbes, in fact, probably the majority. But food, which is, by the way, contrary to what a lot of you have been led to believe, when you have a meal, food actually buffers stomach acid, makes it less acidic. The pH goes up to 3, as high as 4.9. And in that buffered environment, these probiotics have been shown to survive clinically and survive beautifully. So have them with food. Beginning, during, or even immediately after the meal, but always with food, okay? Or else they will be destroyed by your stomach acid. And if you think about it, you know, from a practical sense, if all bacteria required enteric coating, then there would be absolutely no benefit to using sauerkraut or miso or tempeh or kombucha. Are any of these foods enteric coated? Of course not. But how do they survive? Some of them are naturally acid tolerant, and when taken with food, food buffers and offers protection, right? So have them alongside your meal. And just to, sorry? Oh, that was a cough. I'm sorry, I thought someone had a question. I apologize. And then we have our perfect probiotic for children. We have one for kids. And that one is actually in a powder. It's very high potency as well. It's 10 billion. It's in combination with the prebiotic, which is a food for the bacteria, the probiotics, called FOS. By the way, we don't have any FOS in our adult, only in our kids' powder. And that is a powder which, by the way, tastes wonderful because the FOS, which we can't digest nor absorb, but the microbes can ferment, they use it, but we taste it and it tastes sweet. So when you put it in the mouth of a baby or of a child, it actually tastes pleasant enough they don't have to actually mix it with anything else. Mind you, you can add it to yogurt, you can add it to applesauce, but you know, I give it to my son. You know, he actually opens his mouth and wants me to just put it in his mouth directly. And I've done it myself. It tastes actually quite pleasant. But you can add it to, of course, yogurt, or you can add it to applesauce, or apply it to the mom's nipple if the baby's very young and breastfeeding. Okay? And that one, by the way, has 10 species, 8 of which are human-sourced and 2 of which are dairy-sourced. Here we go. So I think I'm about 5 minutes over. Is that okay? Okay. So I do, is there a time for questions and...
Yeah, we can do questions right now, actually.
Can we do some questions now?
I'll wrap it up after.
Okay, brilliant. Yes?
Can you ever take too many?
Great question. If you couldn't hear the question was, can you ever take too many? I think the best way to answer that is to put it into context. A probiotic, even in the hundreds of billions, is a drop of water in a swimming pool of water that is our gut, right? There is a product in the market called VSL number 3, which I've actually been talking about for many years. It's been shown clinically to be effective for things like Crohn's. And it's 450 billion per sachet, and they often indicate three or more pouches a day, which is over 1 trillion, right? Health Canada, up until recently, put a cap on probiotics at about 100 billion per daily dose, unless you as a company had clinicals to prove more were required. But recently, they lifted the cap, so you can actually go as high as you want. You know, I've never, so, I mean, the problem with maybe initially having too much is you may have some gas, some bloating, you may have some diarrhea, constipation. If you have something called SIBO, which by the way is a common problem, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, you wouldn't want to use what's called a prebiotic. You wouldn't want to use foods that have a lot of indigestible fibers like FOS and chicory and inulin, etc., because those foods will actually cause the bacteria. By the way, bacteria that typically produce gas tend to be the bad bugs. This is a generality. They tend to ferment fiber or prebiotics into gas, and the good bugs tend to ferment it into lactic acid. So if a little experiment that was actually taught to me a few years ago by Dr. Plummer was, he said, give someone FOS for a week, and if they turn into a wind instrument, I'm paraphrasing, he never actually said wind instrument, but that's of course my interpretation, they likely have an imbalance in the gut, too many of the bad. And the remedy for that is to take more probiotics and not prebiotic, right? Until you've remedied the problem. Anyone ever heard of SIBO? Quite a common problem that we hear more about. There's actually a great diet called the FOD. If you have a lot of gas, if any of you or any of your friends or family or partners are like just real gas producers, put them on a FODMAP diet. It can be incredibly effective at helping with their gas. Just Google FODMAP diet. It'll tell you which foods contain high levels of these fermentable fibers that could be problematic from a gas perspective. Yeah, you had a question?
Yes. I'm concerned about the point of depression for someone who is on medications for such. Any contraindication, and which one would you choose? Is that the critical support?
You know, that's a great question because, that's a great question. There actually are certain strains that we actually don't even use that have been clinically researched in the context of stress, anxiety, depression, etc. Do you carry any of, like, I know HMF Neuro maybe to some, but that is, I'm not even sure there's any clinicals on.
Yeah, that's the one I would think of right.
Yeah, but I mean, I don't think there's actually direct clinicals on those strains. But that's tricky because right now we're still at a point where they're trying to isolate which are the microbes that have the greatest impact on these various sort of, you know, GABA and serotonin precursors, right? So I will say this is just strictly anecdotal because there hasn't been any study on this specifically for stress and anxiety, but we've had a lot of clients who said they had stress or an anxiety and used this and it actually helped them significantly. In fact, I have a funny story. There's a product that the company I consult for makes that is great for stress and anxiety. And somebody, without going into the specifics, somebody thought they were actually using that supplement for stress and anxiety, and then it turns out they're actually using our probiotic. And they were like, oh my God, this product works so well, and it turns out what they're actually using was a probiotic and not this specific stress formula, right? Which, by the way, does work. If you have a lot of stress and anxiety, it's called Viva, and it's got a natural product number. It's a Health Canada approved natural product for this. It's called Viva Stress, and there's one called Viva Anxiety. It's the first anxiety remedy, if you will, that's Health Canada approved, that's natural for anxiety. It's got an NPN on it. It's called Viva. Do you carry the Viva Anxiety and Stress?
We carry the stress one.
But
okay.
What about if they're on, you know?
Yeah, if they're on a SSRI or there's some sort of med for depression, I've never come across, and maybe any one of you can offer some input on this, I've never come across which is suggesting that it's contraindicated when someone is on an antidepressant. But have you had any research to suggest, theoretically, yeah, correct.
And so it actually works more effectively.
So which one would you recommend, the 150, is that?
I would probably go with the 70 or the 150, absolutely. Yeah, I'm a big believer, if you've got a real
if you've got some a significant condition, be it the mind, the gut, for example, I didn't go into this as well, like my son has cystic fibrosis, so I am very passionate about probiotics because they reduce inflammation in the lungs, right? So he's on every probiotic under the sun that you can imagine, right? And a lot of them actually been clinically shown to benefit lung inflammation and help the lungs. So I'm a big believer. He's been taking like 30 billion since birth, you know? So I always say, I tend to favor higher versus lower potencies. When you consider the fact, and it's a rather silly analogy, if dysbiosis or the bad bugs are contributing to that state, that you know, state of imbalance, you need to fight fire with fire. You don't send in 100 troops when you've got 2,000 enemies. You kind of got to send in some real numbers to combat and kind of get that back in check. And to Dave's point with the food poisoning, you want to use it, and you want to use if you can more. And you want to start using it as soon as you can. I mean, the earlier the better, but it's never too late. So I would go 70 to 150. But because I have no actual direct, it's kind of hard to say which would be the best. I would likely, if you were to ask me, I would go with the higher potency. Yeah. And by the way, the trend, both in industry and in the research, has been largely over the last 10 years, more and more in terms of strain varieties and higher potencies. Years ago, 10 years ago, they were in the millions. I remember 15 years ago, oh my God, there's 10 million bacteria in this capsule. And I was like, that's insane. And now 10 million is like, 10 million. It's not, I'll take that in dollars, but it's not a lot in the world of bacteria. Yeah.
Is it then better to open up the capsule and put it in your food or just to take
it? I would say try to do both, maybe alternate. Because our capsule provides no protection to the bacteria, it's just a delivery mechanism, a delivery vessel, open them all up if you want. I open it frequently throughout the week.
Would you not your stomach acid dissolve it? Or?
Yeah, the capsule will break down your stomach anyway, so it's going to inevitably end up as a powder mixed in with your gastric juices inevitably anyway. So you can, for it to dissolve? It all depends. I know that cellulose apparently takes a little bit longer. These are veggie caps. They're cellulose-based. They apparently take a little bit longer than gelatin, which is either pig, bovine, or fish gelatin. They tend to be quicker than cellulose. I don't have the exact time. And there's a lot of variables. How strong your stomach acid, there's probably a lot of variables at play. But cellulose does break down a little bit slower. But either way, it's not the capsule's providing no protection. So you can open up every single capsule every single time and add it to. I wouldn't add it to your piping hot food because it'll harm it. But you certainly could add it to a yogurt, a protein shake, something like that. Yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah. Sorry, you had a question first.
This is embarrassing. But anyway, if someone goes to the bathroom and it smells really, really bad, is that an indication that they've got a bad gut or?
I mean, okay. For example, this is actually very relevant in the case of one of the things that often is initially a clue to someone having a CF before genetic testing even came around. If someone doesn't digest their food well, in specific it's fat, in the case of someone with CF, their poo is very stinky. So one might argue that if someone has some sort of pancreatic insufficiency or a bile insufficiency, do you have your gallbladder removed out of curiosity? Or people that oftentimes I've talked to that have a pancreatic or bile insufficiency tend to have stinkier poo because it's not properly digested, broken down, and then the bugs have a chance to make it sort of smell a bit off, right? It tends to, if you will, almost ferment in the gut. So I don't know if there's another, I've never come across that being an indicator of dysbiosis. Gas seems to be a much better one. But maybe stinky poo may be one as well. I mean, it may be very well to do with your digestion, the level of digestion, the amount of hydrochloric acid you produce in the stomach, and it could just be the foods that you choose. I mean, the foods that you eat could be very, very much.
I'm not.
I mean, most things how you were opened up and more personal. If I ever have been in a bind, and I guess it's sort of a good choice of words, and I'm on the road somewhere, and I often finish these trainings, and I haven't had a chance to eat, and I do a drive-through, and I eat something less than great, that next day, my poo doesn't smell so great. So the foods that you consume most certainly impact, and I'm not suggesting you may have the most wonderful diet possible. Oh, it's somebody else. Okay. That other person... Your friend, your friend. Right, okay, it's always our friend. Our friend who has stinky poo could be having just bad foods, right? And by the way, I always usually say during my presentation, if you ever do pass wind, you know, if you have a pet, it's a simple thing to blame your dog. Oh,
did it, yeah.
You know, my dog did it, right? Just if people don't know the term, just say, oh, that wasn't me, that was my microbiota. They'll be like, oh, okay. Just blame it on your microbes, because it's your microbes that produce all your gas. You're not doing any, you're not farting, your microbes are. Okay, so. Okay, any, yes, you had your hand up next.
I buy your product from Inside You off the shelf, and I take it home and I read the package, and it says the product is stabilized, but you should still put it in the fridge.
Yeah, so here's
it. But what if it's already deteriorated because it's being stored on the shelf?
Yeah, it actually is very shelf stable. Okay, so this is actually a stability study using our actual probiotic family. Now, two things you want to be aware of. Cryoprotection is a special method of freeze drying that we use to stabilize our probiotic. And at 6 months out of the fridge at room temperature, or 20 degrees Celsius, it's still 55% potent. At one year, 50%. At 24 months, 34%. However, this is the big however, we put 100 to almost 200% more in there than label claim. So the HCP70 is almost nearly double the dose at time of manufacture. We put in more to account for some of that natural die-off, right? So it is actually very stable. I mean, I often travel with it all the time and come home, and frankly, I don't even often put it in the fridge because I know I'm going to be going off on the road again sometime in a matter of days or weeks, right? So you will still have that potency, but I do suggest, you know, I would imagine at the store they turn over fairly quickly, right? So once you get it home, if you can, put it in the fridge. It will certainly extend shelf life to some extent. Any good quality probiotic should have built into the formula measures that stabilize it in such a way that it actually is fairly shelf stable. So we not only use this, we use what's called desiccants to address moisture. We use antioxidants like vitamin C to address oxidation. So we use a number of strategies to make it as stable as possible. But if you can keep it in the fridge, that is sort of my ideal scenario. When you get home, bring it home and put it in the fridge. Yeah. Okay? Yes. Okay.
The reason I bought it was because I didn't have to refrigerate it because I really had no access to a fridge all
the time. For sure. And to the best of my knowledge, even those quote-unquote ones that state clearly on the label, shelf-stable, would have a greater potency over a longer stretch of time if they were kept in the fridge. Because most probiotics they're alive, but they're dormant. They're in a freeze-dry, sort of like a bear going into hibernation. It's alive, but it's metabolically kind of asleep, right? So you can keep them dormant. And in fact, there are bacteria that were found in the tombs in Egypt that were brought back to life just by applying heat and moisture in the right conditions, right? So a lot of microbes, in fact, often it's the most stable ones are ones that are spore formers. But the point being that when you have one that's shelf stable, I would still make the point, and I'd have to verify this, that it would still be likely the shelf life would be extended were it kept in the fridge. Okay? Someone else? Yes?
I wanted to know if you start off with a high dose of 150, do you have to keep that up for the rest of your life, or can you lower it?
Well, you can. I mean, the idea is the critical support is meant for someone that's got a more significant issue going on. And then once you've hopefully achieved some normalcy and you've got some of that gut health restored, you most certainly can go down to more of a maintenance dose. So you want to usually use a more therapeutic dose until you get whatever you're trying to get under control. And then you can go down to a lower dose. And we've seen it happen quite often where someone's got some significant dysbiosis, they use the highest potency they can, things start to normalize, be it say they've got, you know, chronic constipation or the like, and they'll go down to a much lower dose. But if it comes back again, unfortunately you got to go back up again, which we often do see. Sadly, if you've got dysbiosis, the question one has to, it's sort of like the whole discussion with cancer. You know, if you have cancer and you do chemo and radiation therapy and then you stop, and the doctor says, okay, you're cured, but you go, you live the life the way you led before you got the cancer, whatever was there that was the trigger that caused the cancer to begin with hasn't been corrected or changed, so yeah, it comes back. And if what's created the dysbiosis is diet, lifestyle, chronic stress, overuse of antibiotics, if you don't modify that part of your lifestyle, your diet, it's inevitable that it's going to come back to whatever's going to come back that you had before is going to come back again if you lower the dose. Yeah. I'm just gonna, go ahead.
Is there any studies done on the effect of probiotics against some or for somebody with mental illness?
Like Down syndrome? Well, I mean, mentally. I'm sorry, that's a genetic. I'm sorry. Like, for example.
Well, like my background is psychiatric nursing. So
okay.
Like, say, if my clients were given probiotics, would it improve their.
And it very well might be. There's actually a great summit. Have you heard of the. Were you on the Gut Summit?
The Gut Summit.
Yeah. And they actually had some psychiatrists, they had some microbiologists that were doing a lot of research on the gut-brain axis that are having extraordinary results. Do you have a link to the Gut Summit that you could?
I'll give you some information. I have three papers that were written by Alan Logan.
Okay.
And Eva Selhoff from Harvard. And Alan's a naturopathic doctor that's a good friend of mine. And he actually wrote a three-part paper on From Metchnikoff to Modern Medicine.
Okay.
The whole idea of mental illness and the gut-brain connection. So I can
yeah. And I have a number of studies as well that have shown a very strong correlation. I mean, if you're in practice and you're a psychiatrist, psychologist, if you're working with patients that have mental illness, probiotics are a must-use. I mean, I know there's a lot of other protocols. I mean, I know with more schizophrenia, like orthomolecular medicine, they tend to use high-dose vitamin mineral therapy, etc. But probiotics for me would be one of those absolute must-use things to complement whatever modalities you're using in your practice. So, absolutely. Actually, you did have a question again. And I just.
How do you know when your guts are sick?
How do you know? Well, that's a problem. Sometimes you may not know. I mean, there's some obvious signs. Like I gave examples of, gas and bloating and chronic constipation, diarrhea. You know, we know that probiotics modulate or regulate inflammation. So a lot of inflammatory conditions can be controlled through simply establishing normalcy in the gut. But I mean, one way to know, there's a hydrogen breath test, okay? And this is more for SIBO, but do you have that equipment available to you? It's not cheap, I hear, right? Okay, so it's like think of it a breathalyzer, right? And yeah, that sounded pretty good, actually. So you blow into this thing, it won't sound quite that loud in the clinic, hopefully, and what it does is it measures the hydrogen output in your breath, right? So these bad bugs, as I mentioned, produce gas, and once the gas gets, the gas gets, by the way, reabsorbed into the bloodstream, and then we actually eliminate the gas through exhalation, it's like the H. pylori. Anyone have an H. pylori test? Where they test your breath. Anyway, you breathe out and it measures this gas output, and it can tell you with a certain degree of accuracy, I think it's something like 70%, if you've got a dysbiotic gut. You can also go the other route, which is you actually can get stool samples. There's actually a place in the US and one in Europe, and I can't remember what the cost is. In fact, I just was made aware of this recently. You actually can send you a kit, and you send your stool sample, and they analyze your stool to see what microbes are there, and if they're in balance or not, yeah. So there are tests you can do. I would imagine if you come and see Jacqueline, she can offer you some more direction in that regard. Okay. Yes.
I just want to share something.
Please.
My mother went into the hospital to have surgery. When she was in there, the lady across from the bed, she got strep.
Okay.
Disease, the bad thing, and they were coming in and cleaning my mom's curtains and testing her.
Was it strep or MRSA?
Some kind of
Yeah, MRSA, which is yeah.
Yeah, it's strep. Have to do everything.
It's that Staph aureus, yeah.
But they did move her until they tested her, and she tested okay. But we put her on probiotics before she went in. And even though that woman got it, and they did all the sterilization, my mother never got it.
Brilliant. Now, it could have been purely just luck of the draw, but it may have had a lot to do with the probiotics. And no one knows.
The doctor said, I put my mom on probiotics. Did that have anything to do with it? You're a very smart
yeah.
family.
And I would have to agree, because you know what? I mean, if I had a loved one going into hospital, without fail,
they would be on a probiotic, especially if they had to go on antibiotics, because the, you know, when I was in microbiology, there's certain microbes that only live in hospital environments. They can't be ever found. They can't isolate them outside of a hospital environment. These are the these hospital strains. These and you get these what's called nosocomial infections, which are infections you only get in a hospital. You can't get anywhere outside of. So do I want a loved one to be protected? You better believe it. And I would use a bunch of things. I'd use glutamine. I'd use a. Yeah, beautiful. Wonderful. Well, thank you for sharing that. Yeah. And that was your mom, not a friend. That was your mom. Okay. Okay.
We're going to do a draw.
Okay.
For the gift bag. So what's in here?
There you go.
What's in here? If you want to say what's in, why don't you say what's in here?
I'm actually seeing it for
okay,
the first.
So veggie greens.
Veggie essentials. Got protein, veggie greens, and a malty.
Okay, it's, we've got the symbiotic. Kit.
It's our pre and probiotic, the food for the good guy and the good guy.
Yeah, well, I think this is the. There's just the symbiotic kit's worth 70. This is worth probably 35 or 40.
Yeah, almost $40.
$40. And there's the kids one.
And the kids probiotic as well.
Yeah, so it's like a $120 gift basket right
there. That's right. All right. And a lovely bow on top, which is worth at least $5.
Really nice. So you hold that. And then I'll do the drum roll.
Okay.
And you can pick that.
Okay.
And read it out.
And the lucky winner is?
And the lucky winner is?
43-02-02-17.
Yay!
Yay!
Come on up.
Congratulations. There you go.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. You're welcome. It doesn't matter, you can, yeah, great.
So, Nelson, that was brilliant.
Thank you very much.
I knew that was going to be. Did everyone enjoy Nelson's talk? Can we give him a round of applause?
Thank you.